This Victrola produced state-of-the-art audio back in the day. Fast forward to today, you'll find purveyors of sound systems of every sort presenting their wares and saying, now hear this. Our cover story is reported now by John Blackstone.
This morning, we're showcasing the very latest in high-end audio technology. Yes, vinyl long-playing records, introduced back in 1930, are still state-of-the-art. That is, if you play them on a $50,000 Brinkman Balance turntable. Why do I want to go back to the old turntable with a needle and tubes and big speakers?
For that, you'll just have to sit down and listen.
At Music Lovers Audio in Berkeley, California.
Welcome to our reference room.
Will Klein took us for a spin through the highest in high fidelity components. This is four different CD players.
No, this is one CD player.
The experience reminds you of those old Maxell tape ads, sound that blows you away. Be prepared to have your budget blown away, too.
What does a system like this cost?
Over $100,000.
Okay. I don't know how to follow that.
Throw in a suitable amplifier and speakers, and you're easily in the hole for $250,000 or more. But take heart. You don't have to break the bank to tap into some cutting-edge sounds.
From high-end listening rooms to the music player we carry around in our pocket, technology is now delivering more music to more places than ever.
We're very close to a future where just about every recorded song that we know of is just a couple clicks away on your phone.
Doesn't matter how big a record collection you might have at home, what's in your pocket is going to be bigger.
It should be bigger. All that data still will exist in big cloud servers. Your phone is going to be your window into basically all of music. I do a lot of searching around the deep corners of the internet for cool new bands.
Caleb Garling, technology writer at the San Francisco Chronicle, sees the future of music in companies like Spotify and Pandora that send, or to use the proper lingo, stream music to phones, cars, and home computers. There are inexpensive subscriptions for sale, but most listeners choose to pay nothing and endure a steady stream of ads in exchange for free music.
Now on Spotify for the first time ever.
I grew up listening to music for free. It was called the radio.
All right.
How is it different today?
In some ways, it's not at all. There are a lot of people who listen to music all day without paying a cent.
Some streaming services let listeners pick specific songs. Others, like Pandora, figure out what kind of music a listener wants.
Each song has a musicological fingerprint, if you will.
Michael Adicott works on Pandora's Music Genome Project, training the company's computers to serve as a personal disc jockey. Click thumbs up or thumbs down on a song, and the system gets to know your tastes even better, they claim, than those closest to you.
This is really the cornerstone of our recommendation technology, and I think it is probably better than the recommendations your wife could make.
Pandora, based in Oakland, California, is the granddaddy of the streaming business, founded all of 14 years ago by Tim Westergren.
We stream more hours of music every month than YouTube streams hours of video. Around 80 million people come every month to Pandora. So we actually are now the biggest radio station in virtually every market in the U.S.
Although recording industry revenues are less than half of what they were a decade ago, streaming services offer new hope. Digital music piracy is now in the decline. It seems most people find it easier to stream than to steal.
Is this a golden age for people who love music?
I think it is. The utopia really is that every artist reaches the audience they deserve.
Streaming sites paid out more than $1 billion in royalties to record labels in 2012, the most recent numbers available. But the amount they pay each time a song is played is tiny, as little as 0.6 cents, and only a fraction of that ultimately goes to musicians. It's left many of those who make music complaining this golden age for listeners is leaving them in the dark ages. Money.
The margins on the songs themselves are trending towards zero, and that's a reality of the music industry right now.
Tech writer Caleb Garling says that today's musicians would be wise to follow the business model of a San Francisco band that found fortune long before the internet age. The Grateful Dead. The Dead encouraged their tie-dyed fans to record concerts and trade tapes. Others in the music business considered that stealing.
A lot of people like to joke that maybe the Grateful Dead was the first, like, social media band, because they allowed people to record their shows, and that was viral marketing for their shows and for their merchandise.
It helped create those loyal fans known as Deadheads, who crowded into shows. Over three decades, the Grateful Dead had only one top 10 hit. But at their peak, they took in $50 million or more a year from performing live. Every silver lining's got a
touch of gray. You've always been experimenting in a way.
Curiosity killed the cat, but satisfaction brought it back. That's what we're up to here. We're finding stuff out.
Grateful Dead guitarist Bob Weir may be showing more than a touch of gray these days, but he hasn't lost his enthusiasm for playing and promoting music. And he sees live performances streamed on the internet as the way young musicians can build a fan base.
The Phoenix will have to rise from the ashes, because the music industry as we have known it is destroyed. You know, one of my big concerns is that artists have to be able to make a living. Something new will have to arrive, and we're here to help that be born.
Weir recently founded the Tamil Pious Research Institute, perhaps the world's most high-tech studio for streaming live audio and video on the internet.
The kind of work that went into this, the kind of expense that went into this, you described it as what? An unlimited budget, but...
Yeah, well, Bob, he had an unlimited budget. He exceeded that by half, and we continue to.
Chris McCutcheon is CEO of TRI. He and Weir hope the same technology that has hurt record sales will help sell audiences on live performances. As much as the music business is changing, one thing is certain.
People are going to need music, so that need is not going to go away. I would love to see the best and the brightest starting to come back to the arts. And one of the ways of doing that is to make it both aesthetically and financially rewarding. In another time's
forgotten space. For listeners, of course, music is its own reward, no matter how it reaches your ears.